Ham Radio Now, episode 112. And we're beginning with the first of the technical talks from the 2013 ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference held in September back in Seattle. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and we're going to start on Friday morning with the first of the talks. John Hays, K7VE, changed the name of it just a little bit by the time he got up there on stage and made his slide. It's going to be a dynamic web interfaces for digital two-way radio. And we'll get started with that in just a minute. But first, I wanted to thank the group of hams who contributed to the successful Kickstarter that got me out there to shoot the programs and are contributing to getting them produced here online. About 115 hams came up with more than half of our Kickstarter goal. So thanks to all of you guys. And then we had three of what I've been calling the corporate underwriters that came up with the other half, a little bit more than the other half. And we've got TAPR itself. TAPR is a membership organization, hams who are interested in the digital aspects of amateur radio. And you can find TAPR online at tapr.org. So thanks to TAPR for helping out. Elecraft. And Elecraft has a growing line of ham radio equipment. It's anchored by their K3 and KX3 HF and 6-meter transceivers. And they both do 2 meters, too, if you put in an optional transverter that goes right on inside. You can find them on the web at elecraft.com. And finally, by Flex Radio Systems. And in each program, I'm going to talk in a little bit more length about one of those underwriters. And this time, it's Flex's turn. Flex, of course, is featuring their new 6000 series of software-defined transceivers. I want to stay away from the usual endless list of features. The cool thing about the 6000 series is that they convert a huge block of RF from 330 kilohertz up to 77 megahertz directly to digital, pretty much right from the antenna connector. And they do just about everything else, like demodulating and filtering, in the digital domain. That lets them do things like have up to 8 fully independent receivers with 4 pan adapters, they call these slice receivers, operating at the same time anywhere in that huge block of spectrum. These receivers are all super high performance with amazing dynamic range, multiple filters, unlimited memories, and there I go with the laundry list of features. With the 6000 series, Flex has moved the heavy lifting, the advanced computer processing, onboard the radio. You still use a computer interface to control everything through a GUI, but now your computer is just the interface, so it can be a much simpler device. Eventually, you can expect interfaces for tablets and even smartphones, and networked operation from anywhere with an internet connection.
What we've done is we've decided to simplify. Mm-hmm. So buttons only pop up when you need them. Displays go away if you don't need them, or you can shrink them and expand them as you need. So we're really trying to hide that behind the scenes stuff and right. Just present to you what feels right and intuitive.
There are 2 transceivers and 1 receiver in the series. The 6500 and 6700 are both 100 watt HF plus 6 meter transceivers, and the 6700R is basically the receiver out of the 6700 transceiver. The 6500 has 4 of those slice receivers. The 6700 has a beefier processor, so it can do 8 receivers, and it and its receiver version add VHF coverage from 135 to 165 megahertz. Now, if you want to get started a little bit more modestly, the Flex 3000 and 1500 series radios are still available. The 3000 is a 100-watt transceiver in a case that you can slip into a suitcase and still have plenty of room left over for your clothes. It has some analog conversion stages before its A to D converter, but it still meets some really good performance specs, and it's still controlled from your PC screen. The 1500 is a QRP transceiver that you can operate from 1 milliwatt, now there's a QRP challenge, up to 5 watts on HF through 6 meters. Connection to your PC is by a simple USB cable, there's no audio cables to mess around with, and as usual, your PC provides the user interface. The 1500 also makes a great IF and first stage exciter for driving VHF and UHF transverters. In the U.S., Flex radios are all sold directly from the Flex Radio website. That's flexradio.com. Outside the U.S., Flex uses a network of international distributors and service centers, and you'll find them on the Flex website, too. So let's head back to Seattle and let TAPR President Steve Bible, N7HPR, introduce our first talk.
Let's bring John Hays on up, and we'll get started.
So I want to start off with our Chamber of Commerce kind of let us down for this show. We try to promote the idea that this is a horrible, dreary, gray, wet area that no one would ever want to live in. Unfortunately, about 6 million people disagree with us, so they showed up. But enjoy the sun, step out, look at beautiful Mount Rainier, the Puget Sound. If you want to go downtown and you didn't have a car, if you go over to the airport, you can take the shuttle from here. There's a light rail there that goes right to downtown Seattle. So it's very inexpensive, very efficient, easy. Take advantage of that while you're here if you can. So I'm part of that group, Northwest Digital Radio, promoters of what many people think is the mythical UDR 56K. Let me just start off by saying we were hoping to get a lot of stuff done on it this summer, but we had this strange event for the Northwest. We had a solar event, and some of our developers and that took advantage of that, but we're back kicking it. We've made a lot of progress in the last 2 or 3 weeks. I won't go into a lot of detail on that. The second thing is this topic is very broad and deep, and so we can only touch the top of it. I'll be here all weekend long, and if my car works, I'll be taking off Sunday afternoon. No, actually, I have a reliable car. But if you have any questions about the aspects, so we'll kind of be glazing the top. We figured people are still waking up with the coffee, so they just wanted the donut with the glaze over it. We'll go a little bit into depth, but not really deep. See if my magic stick here works. There we go. Takes me right back to the same page. Whoa, pushed the wrong button. We moved on. Okay, so over the course of many years, the software side of Amperature Radio, we've tended to try to build applications to do really cool things, but in the initial phases of that, we were working with hardware that was a little less than capable. Anyone here familiar with the W0RLI BBS, which was one of the first packet BBSs? I introduced him to the Xerox 820. Unfortunately, he left us here not too long ago. But that box, and actually it was a bare board, was made by Xerox, and very low memory, very slow CPU. We packed a lot into those applications, and it started kind of a trend of roll our own to solve problems that either there wasn't a current solution for, or we just didn't have the horsepower for. I'm here to talk about maybe a little better way to approach. As we do the UDR, we've spent a lot of time thinking about how to make this the most flexible, most available type of architecture. And Brian, who's another member of our team, will be presenting this afternoon how that architecture's laid out. But I'll just touch on some of the things that we figured out from software. Actually, many of the applications we run don't need a GUI at all. No user interface at all. You start them, they run in the background. It's only to make you feel good that you can bring up a screen and look, yeah, it's still running, take that screen down. we shouldn't spend a lot of time there building GUIs. Just some configuration tools, get them up and running, let them run, and then use logs to figure out if there was something wrong. Where there is a GUI need, and there are applications that need that, you really have to think as a designer, not as a code hack, okay? I write code. Many people in this room probably write code much better than I. But I also, in my day job, I'm an IT executive for a company here in the area, and underneath me is support, development, and creative design. And one of the things you learn when you get that group of people together is what makes sense to the coder doesn't necessarily make sense to the market. So you really need to think about the market that you're going for. If the market's just you, then do whatever you want. If you're building something that you want a wider community to use, you need to think about that market. If you're going to build a solution that requires someone to drag a desktop computer along with them to use, you're never going to do mobile applications. Well, you might, but not all of us have Hummers. So think about that. Think where the various components are going to run. Hello, wake up. There we go. There are components to almost all amateur radio applications that we do in the data space. Command and control, you know, that's your typical set your frequency, set your mode, pick a protocol, hook it all together. That mostly can run in a daemon. You have some command and control that needs an interface, but the rest of it's kind of buried in. Once it's set, it's set. You just leave it there. In some of our more modern protocols and technologies, we need to detect a radio signal. We need to package it in a protocol. We may have a modem involved. We may have a vocoder involved, such as AMBI or Codec 2. There may be some digital signal processing. Almost all of that should just be in the hardware or in a daemon running in the background somewhere. And then you have the presentation level, which is kind of what we're going to try and focus on a little bit more today. That's presentation of visual, audio, and controls to affect changes with the program. So where will the application run? Well, obviously it's going to run on a penguin. The reality is we have an OS technology rich field for targets, and we'll often pick the one that we're most comfortable with. And hey guys, we got seats down here for you. Hey Kenny. One of the people that helped put this together, by the way. So think about that. Most of us are comfortable in one, maybe two OS environments, and it's okay to code your code there, keeping in mind that your users may not be as familiar or want to use that same environment. There are some common OS services that are available in all of these operating systems, so please don't reinvent them. There's a network stack, there's process management, there's security, at least for most of them. There's an OS-specific native GUI. There's typically a web browser, there's typically a web server. And then there's all the hardware interfaces, whether it be serial, USB, parallel I/O, GPIO, Ethernet, attack lasers, whatever you might need to hook to. That will typically happen through an OS server, a service of some sort. So use the ones that exist. Don't duplicate or reinvent OS-provided services and applications. And don't create one-off solutions for network or OS services where they already exist. Now, who here is familiar with JNOS? Okay, JNOS was a marvelous piece of technology that was created 30 years ago because OSs didn't have these services. You don't need to have a program that's running in user space without the built-in security and the deep hooks into the OS that just provides common functions like email and file transfer and so on. Use the tools that are out there. Use the creative noodle to create something new and useful and valuable. Your market is typically going to be ham radio operators. Some of the markets are emergency communication support, data, messaging, digital voice, and ad hoc networking. And this is typically to share information. We have these analogs in digital to some of the services that people are used to on the internet. We have our own Twitter. What is it? APRS messaging. We have file transfer. We have web services. We have who here is familiar with the I'm losing the name of it right now. There's a package out there, open source, for doing your computer-aided dispatch for when you have people in the field and keeping track of them on a map and doing all the things that you would typically do in computer-aided dispatch. We got, pardon? No, it's a different one, but possibly that one. At least I was thinking of a different one. And that's your situational awareness. We've got a lot of people playing with meshing, ad hoc networking, trying to address different things. I don't know if we have a presentation on HamWAN here this weekend, but that's an effort here in the Puget Sound area. We do have one? Good. That's a 5 gigahertz network to deliver up to about 150 megabits to end nodes using a cell architecture, and it's all on Net 44, the ham radio network. So that's cool. And we're always playing with new modulation techniques, new protocols, so your architecture and programs should keep that in mind. In the UDR, we made the choice that we weren't even going to have physical controls on the radio other than pull the power on and off. All control is via the network. And frequency, power, protocol, modulation, so on, is selected over the network. You need to be able to monitor the environment sometimes, like on the UDR. Many of these will be deployed in hostile environmental situations. We've got one group here in the area that was thinking about, so how do we build a network and have it somewhere where people aren't going to destroy it because it's unattended equipment? And they figured out throughout the entire city that is looking at this, they have sewage pump stations that already have internet, and they're not a place people hang out. So you want to monitor such things as temperature, voltages coming in, that kind of thing. And the performance of the system, what's the received signal, what's the bit error rate going in and out on that circuit. And then you have, what type of data are you going to carry? Are you going to be carrying ham Twitter? Are you going to be carrying bulk data like the buoy network down in the Gulf that they use APRS to keep track of trends along the Gulf Coast? There's all kinds of applications. Some are streamed, it's just a constant stream of data coming over. Typically, depending on the requirements, that might be like voice traffic, so there are parameters you have to think about there, or packet switched when it doesn't really matter if it's a second late, kind of thing. So there's a software challenge to all of this, and you need to talk to the hardware. Often an application will have multiple stages. So the approach that I'm taking and we're taking in what we're building right now, which I think is a pretty good architecture, is at every stage of your pipeline, you provide a socket. And that socket can be interfaced to a user interface so that you can control it, monitor it, pass traffic through it, and out through a socket interface. Boy, this thing like should really point it. The other thing that, and this goes back to the design aspect, is we have a target-rich client environment now. And there's multiple operating systems, there's smartphones, there's tablets, there's desktops, there's purpose-built hardware. You have to think about things like internationalization. That's what I-18N stands for, because there's 18 characters between I and N. Support for people with disabilities. I'm partially blind. It's nice to have voice prompts at times, or the ability to make the font much bigger. I can read that better than I can read this. And you're going to have intra and inter-application data streams going back and forth, straight on the processor, over the internet, to some non-UI endpoint. So you got to keep all of these things in mind when you're building your application. So we tried a few things. We learned a little bit about something called WebSockets, which allows you to have real-time two-way communication between the browser and the client. And as we dug in further, we picked Node.js. Now, there are other frameworks out there, but this is one that's quite popular right now. I gave a portion of this talk mixed with some other things to the local Node.js users group, who are professional developers, and there were 80 people in the room, and I asked them, how many of you were nerds? And about half the room put their hands up, and I said, how many of you have ham licenses? My son kept his up. I says, you're not nerds, because you got to have the other side of it. But they loved it. I mean, they just ate it up. They were so excited about marrying this real-time framework with real devices that pass real information over RF. And, you know, I had questions. Are you guys planning to take your radio and send it to African villages so they can get connected into the world? And I said, well, first we got to take care of the amateurs, but we've had people approach us with those types of ideas. I see Kurt Black back there. You know, we could tie little things to bats, and you could monitor them and pass it back from there. In case you don't know Kurt, he's kind of batty. He's kind of a world-level expert on bats that we're fortunate to have in this area. And birds. We were out to a barbecue at Ken's house, and he could name every bird for 10 miles that we could hear the slightest chirp out of. But you bring those kinds of applications to a radio environment, you can advance science, you can advance social connectivity, you can bring the richness of a connected world to the disconnected world. And that's a noble goal, I think. And by building your applications right, they may be focused to amateur radio, but they may expand out into other areas. So we had to introduce that to the programmers. Took a little while to learn, but it's not a hard technology to learn. So a couple of quick do's and don'ts. Don't create custom address distribution. I see so many AM applications where we have this great thing called DNS, and they pass around on USB drives the addresses of all the systems that participate in the network. Let the tools that are out there do the job they were designed to do. Don't recreate it. And please don't limit your design to the OS you're familiar with and comfortable with. So we propose using published interfaces to the web that people can do their own user space design and present it in a way that's useful for different audiences and just passing the traffic back and forth. And I'll have one example here in just a second. So everyone here is familiar with DNS as being, you put in a host name and it turns an address, right? Anyone not familiar with that? Okay. Well, it has a lot more richness to that than that, and a lot of people don't realize that. One of the things that can be done is something called a service record. And a service record allows you to identify a protocol. In this case, I'm using one of the D-Star linking protocols, DCS, and you tell what family packet it's running on, in this case UDP, or datagrams. I set up a test domain to test this out, and I have a few thousand records in there. And so you ask with the host system or command here for the service records for this protocol, and it returns quite a few more than this, but I cut out some. And these are hosts on the network that service this protocol. And another neat thing is you can tell it which port that it's listening to in the at that address. And then, of course, it just looks up the address from the host name, or you can actually just put the address there. This allows some flexibility. Some of the things that we've run into is the designer picks a port, advertises it as a well-known port, but it's well-known to another application, and that creates a problem. So this allows the software that we're writing to not only identify the host, but that host can advertise a UDP port or a TCP port that it's listening on, and the application can use that one instead of a well-known port and move it off to a different space. So now we start getting down. So that's all fine and good from the command line. How do we bring this into a web application? Well, here's the same function inside of JavaScript. There's a package called DNS. You make a call. Whoops, am I messing myself up here? Okay. You make a call to a function attached to DNS. To resolve a service, you give it the service name and a function. It uses a callback mechanism because Node.js is non-blocking. So it'll go off and do this in the background and return through this function the results when they complete and can just step on and be doing something else. So it makes for really good real-time applications. So it returns addresses. And then we walk through the address array, and if there's an error, it throws an error. And then I'm just going to, for this example, show you what's returned. So it returns an array of those records that we saw before, and we can use these to build GUI. We can use these to make selection of the ports, what servers we're going to hook to, and so forth, inside of an application. And this is a pretty simple piece of code, right? And I've applied it to some things that are kind of half-baked, so I'm not going to directly demo them today, but getting there. I'm using this in some designs. So you start out by learning about WebSockets. And the cool thing about WebSockets is you can use different technologies to generate them. If you happen to be a Python fan, there's a whole library for it. If you happen to be a C fan, there's a whole library for it. But these are traditionally web applications have kind of been the user of the web client asks for some information and waits for it to be returned, and then it just sits there and waits for you to interact with it again. What the WebSocket does is it keeps a pipe open between the front end and the back end so that the application running in the background can send updates continuously to the front end. And we usually capture these with JavaScript or a similar type of front end language. And we can update displays. So if you want to update what frequency I'm on as I'm switching the frequency, you can do that, and as the back end catches up, it puts it on the front end. In the case of the DCS records we were just looking at, it can populate a pull down so you can pick the destination station you want to talk to. You can also use WebSockets with non-web applications. It's just a name for technology. Another thing I found really useful is a lot of programs out there already use well-known ports and well-known protocols, and sometimes you don't need to rewrite them because you know where they're talking, and so you can use a technique called packet sniffing to go and look at the packets as they go past and extract information from them. And I've done that with several DSTAR applications where I haven't gone in and rewritten them to use WebSockets directly, but I have a proxy in between that is watching the traffic as it goes over the network and then presenting the updates as they happen in the data stream. You can open sockets to traditional applications, send commands down in their language of choice. You can use authentication, the crypto module. This is not encryption for obscuring the contents of the message. This is simply a hash that you pass back to say, I am who you think I am. And seen it used in a number of applications. So it's a nice clean way to do that, and also the monitoring and radio control. So you take your big application, and now you need to start thinking about it as a network programmer instead of a system programmer, because if you consider the computing requirements, often all of this command and control and probably protocol can be handled on a fairly modest computer. It is time to get rid of the i386 as you have that use 500 watts and keep your garage warm and stuff like that. A Raspberry Pi will handle all of this. And Brian, I saved you a seat down here. The Raspberry Pi is a really good, inexpensive way to handle these protocols, including radio control and assembling and disassembling. And we're going as far in the UDR as creating soft modems, soft protocol engines, and so on that'll all run on that class of processor. Ours is a little bit more powerful. In raw power, in floating point, the Pi actually has floating point instructions. Ours doesn't, but we have a smart mathematician that works for us that is doing all of this in fixed point, which will actually make it faster anyway. The presentation, why do you need a thing that needs to be mounted on your dashboard somewhere just so you can flip a switch and turn a knob, right? I can put a radio that is designed to be divided so that the UI happens on my phone or my tablet or a PC or whatever, and the radio sitting in the trunk of my car and talking to it over Wi-Fi or Bluetooth or some other wireless medium. By the way, it also has a microphone and a speaker. So the presentation layer can be from simple, low-computed computing, you know, push the button to turn it on, to a very dedicated piece of visualization hardware, such as presenting spectral displays or so on. And all of these are being turned into modules that you can load into these frameworks like JSON and bring audio and bring visual and bring data streams and then process them into pretty graphs and maps and so on. Traditionally, we've tried to put this all on one platform, but these are the basic components. You typically have an RF DAC of some kind. If you're doing digital, you've got some kind of a modem or a codec, a vocoder. You've got the command, control, and monitoring configuration component, and you have a presentation UI. And we put that all on one computer. But as I just was explaining, you can divide these in several points along here and put the appropriate piece closest to the hardware it needs to interact with. And by the time you get out to presentation layer, you can be physically disconnected using various protocols we have in the RF space to control and operate and send traffic in and out of the radio. Results, this is one that I run for my D-Star. I just did a quick snap on here, and a few things aren't filled in, but basically, all of this traffic capture is done in real time off of the packet stream going back and forth. And because I'm watching it that way, if, say, Peter was to key up, as he is here, I actually have the display change the presentation of his record to say, he's talking right now. He's on the repeater right now. And when, as soon as he lets up the mic, then it goes back to the normal state. And it does that because it just pushes out records over JSON to the web, which has an open socket. I have APRS capture, and it puts out the APRS strings down at the bottom. I also, in this particular iteration, collect information about the repeaters that are attached to this gateway. And they normally would be listed right here, but the packets hadn't gone through when I needed to get this shot at 12:30 this morning. You have this interface that will run on, you know, very mobile interfaces and clear across the internet. You know, I could connect to it here. My station is actually about 30 miles north of here, and just control it from the web. Just a quick plug on what we're doing with the UDR56K. We've designed a DAC that's 30 watts UHF, 430 to 450 megahertz. It doesn't go down to 420 because of the final amp. I've got the time, thanks. In this part of the state, you can't use 420 to 430, so we figured we'd just leave it out. It's a technological thing. The receiver is quite wide in what it can cover. It has a built-in computing platform based on ARM. It's using IQ two-point modulation and detection, so we can play with whatever waveform factors we want to mathematically inside of the drivers that we have. It has built-in Ethernet for all that command and control and data passing, for USB hosts to attach real-world things in, like you want it to be a tracker, just plug in a US GPS. It's there and it works. A Wi-Fi headset, so on. The modems are software defined, the protocols are all software defined, and we have embedded applications that actually run inside the radio. So gives us the maximum flexibility, and all of the management of this and operation of this will happen through a web interface. So you can take it anywhere. Okay.
How portable is JavaScript across browsers?
Today it's quite portable. In fact, for most of the UI stuff, I use a library called jQuery. And jQuery handles the peculiarities of different browsers. Now, you do have to use a modern browser. But now, yeah, I mean, you know, running a text-based browser, that's not going to work so well with. Basically, we like to see browsers that have WebSocket and HTML5 capability. Most of the modern browsers contain that, regardless of who the manufacturer is. And HTML5 is the up-and-coming standard, which is really cool because you can actually draw widgets and do all kinds of things on the screen and make it look exactly like a green screen radio interface if you want on the display.
I'm Graham, KE9H. You made a very strong point about using DHCP and when it's available. And I guess the question, do you have any opinions for
DNS?
DNS, okay.
Yeah.
Any opinions on how small IP networks should be self-organizing when there is no real network present? In other words, either a picnic table on a field day or an emergency situation when there is no connectivity into the main internet.
Right.
How should a, you know, multi-function, system, you know, self-organized? What protocols do you recommend there?
Well, most every modern operating system has as a service that you can put on a local caching DNS server. So it actually pulls the records from the authority, and when it loses connectivity, it just uses the records it has in memory. So, and you can also have in those proxies locally defined networks that it just serves up itself.
John?
Yeah.
The Bonjour protocol is used for auto configuration of networks.
Right.
And it's DNS based. It uses broadcast. Mm-hmm. It's in Linux and Apple. I'd have to assume that Windows is caught up.
Yeah.
It's an IETF standard. What do you use?
I'm sorry, the question up there.
It's an IETF. We refer to Bonjour as an Apple trademark, but it's
right.
Like,
right.
Known as zero.
Yeah, the Bonjour, comment was there is an IETF standard called Bonjour. I don't know what the standard number
Bonjour
is.
Bonjour is the Apple name. The IETF name is ZeroConf.
Yeah, and those are for self-configuring networks.
Right.
And yes, most modern operating systems have them, including one from Redmond.
John, I actually have a follow-up as well. Why didn't you consider using something like Universal Plug and Play for service discovery?
I'm sorry, which service?
Universal Plug and Play is a service discovery solution. It again sits on top, uses broadcast, and it actually specifically is designed to
right.
Address discovery of things in a
right.
small network.
I'm not opposed to them. I try to find that balance between what's widely available and what provides the best utility with easy programmer access to it, but any one of these discovery protocols would be just fine. There's a couple more. I think there's a paper that there's going to be a talk for later in the program here on another one focused to ham radio need at level 3. Any others? Well, I only saw a few nappers, and we're just in time for Hecky.